Yes, now. Okay, good. So this is an opportunity for us to have a little dialogue and to do some questions and answers, or questions and questions. So I'm happy to simply take questions from the audience. It is a place to start. So please have a low threshold. Feel free to ask whatever may be. Yes, please.
Thank you very much for your talk today.
Hi, thank you for your talk today, Richie. I know you've researched Olympic meditators, people who've meditated for a long time, and you've also researched kind of normal people doing 10 or 20 minutes. And I know in previous talks you've talked about mental exercise being as common as physical exercise, perhaps by the year 2030. So I was wondering what kind of practices would you recommend which would be short, which the mass public could practice, and that could become so common as physical exercise nowadays?
Yeah. So thank you for the great question. I think that if you look at the empirical literature on meditation, the scientific literature, and actually this is something that Dan Goleman and I are currently doing. We're writing a book together, bringing together all of the empirical science on meditation, and also telling a little bit of our joint biographies together. One of the really interesting questions that you can ask is, based on the scientific evidence, what are the practices that have been studied which actually show effects very, very quickly, kind of immediate effects, compared to other practices which may take quite a long time for the effects to emerge? And the data from asking that question are pretty clear if you look at the scientific evidence. And the data clearly show that compassion practices, loving kindness and compassion practices, have much more immediate effects than, quote, mindfulness practices. And so one of the possibilities, and again, this is not something that's been empirically tested, but one of the possibilities is that we can, I think, all be doing very simple loving kindness and compassion practices in everyday life. And also practices of appreciation and gratitude that can provide people with a very direct experience very, very quickly, which I think can be very motivating for them to continue to practice. And so there are all kinds of ways to do that. When I go through an airport, as I look at everyone, and I do go through airports a lot, you can just look at the mass of humanity, and as each person passes you, you can simply wish them to be happy. Very simple. It's amazing what some simple practices of that kind can actually do to transform one's daily life. The direct experience of that, I think, can be very helpful in then motivating individuals to engage in other kinds of practices. So thank you for asking. Yes, please.
I was wondering how specific are the effects of mindfulness or compassion or other contemplative practices, because there's a number of things that are good for us. A walk in the mountains, or exercising, or talking to a friend. What does the data tell us about the more specific effects that doing these kinds of things has on the brain? Where are we now?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I'm often asked a similar question, a related question, which is, individuals might often say, well, I go out for a run every day, or I walk every day. Isn't that meditation? There are a few answers. First, there is a paucity of scientific evidence that has directly compared, particularly within the same participants, those kinds of activities. And we do know that there is this wonderful phenomenon called biophilia. How many of you have heard of biophilia? Really, not a single person. That's amazing. Biophilia is a term that was invented, I think, by E.O. Wilson, Edmund Wilson at Harvard, the very famous evolutionary biologist. And it is a term that connotes our propensity to want to be with nature. Human beings' propensity to be in nature. And there are data showing that if comparing people, if you take a 10-minute walk in nature compared to taking a 10-minute walk in a city, and then you put people in the scanner, you see very different patterns of brain activity. So it's clear that being in nature can be very, very helpful. So I'm sort of skirting around the issue and not directly addressing it. I'll directly address it now. There may be certain elements that are common in walking in nature or in engaging in a sport where there is some kind of attentional focus. But there is a critical difference, I think, which I think will ultimately be found to make a difference in our scientific measures. And that is, when we put our butt on the cushion to meditate or on a seat, we invoke the intention that I'm doing this practice not primarily for myself, but for the benefit of others. It is an altruistic motivation. Now, it's possible to walk in nature in that way or to exercise, physical exercise, in that way. But we don't normally invoke that kind of ethical framework when we do that. But this invites the possibility that we can actually engage in many other activities, particularly leisure activities of daily living, and invoke that same kind of ethical framework where I am doing this activity not primarily for my own benefit, but for the benefit of others. And that simple shift may make a difference in terms of brain function, systemic biological processes. We don't know, but certainly the implication from other evidence is that it would make a difference. And so I would say that that's probably the most important distinguishing characteristic between sort of ordinary leisure time activities and contemplative practice. Yes, and then I'll go back there. Wherever we keep your hands up so the microphone can get to the right place. Thank you.
Thank you. You said earlier in your talk that we all have an innate propensity for goodness. But if you look around in the world with all the cruelty and atrocities we're witnessing, it finds our hard to believe. It's kind of contradictory. So where did that get lost? And is there a way to rekindle it or nurture it? And what can we do about it? It's just so depressing. And as is there any hope to in the world?
Yeah, I can repeat the question. So thank you for asking the question. So the question is really about how can we say that there is innate basic goodness when we look around and we see all the violence and other kinds of negativity in the world. So first of all, let me say that the data actually show that the incidence of violence has dramatically declined in human history, dramatically. Arguments between people used to be solved or adjudicated by having a duel where one of those people ends up dying. That doesn't happen that much anymore. And so if you look at the hard-nosed scientific data on violence, there is absolutely no question that violence is dramatically declining. What has increased is the media amplification. And so we see lots of violence in the media because that's what the media tends to amplify. But when you just reflect on ordinary daily life, I mean, wouldn't everyone agree that the simple acts of gratitude, appreciation, and kindness every day far exceed the number of acts of violence that we witness, even in the worst situations? And so I think that there is an issue with what is being virally amplified. But to more directly address your question, certainly I think there are instances where the human mind has become so deeply conditioned by trauma and other kinds of conditions that it obscures and masks this quality of innate basic goodness. And there's a clinician who actually is local to Madison, but he is known for some of his work with psychopaths, people who are said to lack empathy and who engage in antisocial behavior and who are found in a much greater, or much more extensively represented, for example, among violent incarcerated individuals. And so one of the ways that he works clinically with psychopaths is to actually treat them with respect and with dignity, because they're human beings. And it turns out that when the individuals are addressed in that way and are held in that way, he's found clinically some remarkable opportunities for transformation. Those are individuals who've lived a life that is so imbued with violence and trauma that they're rarely regarded in that way, almost never since birth. And so one of the things that I said in my talk is that innate basic goodness can be thought of like language. We all come into the world with a propensity for innate basic goodness, but it requires the right conditions for it to be nurtured. And so I think that one of the lessons from that is to do what we can to create the conditions to nurture it. And I think that in terms of hope in the world, I put a lot of stock in education for the next generation. And that's why we're working with young kids. We know that in the US, for every dollar that's invested in high-quality preschool intervention, there's a return of $7 on that investment by the time the individuals are 30 years of age. This is work from the Nobel economist Jim Heckman at the University of Chicago, who's done those analyses. And so there's an economic reason to do it, which some people are persuaded by, and also a moral issue here. And I think that there's a lot of evidence to suggest that there's increased plasticity of the brain earlier on in life. That's why it's easier to learn a second language when we begin at this age. It's why it's easier to learn to play a musical instrument, and it is also, I think, easier to nurture compassion. Thank you. Question back there.
I have a question over here.
Please.
I wonder, how do you see that this wonderful knowledge that you all bring can be realized in our political world today?
Well, if you're in the United States, it's really quite a scene. There is a little bit of, I think, cause for optimism. There is one member of the United States Congress who is an openly declared meditator. His name is Tim Ryan. He has written a book called The Mindful Nation, which I highly recommend. I think that it's a very difficult problem, and I think that, again, this is where educating the next generation, I think, is really important. We are doing our best to change the culture so that we can get this into every school. I think that if kids get a taste of this early on in life, it has multiplicative effects as they develop. And so while it's certainly the case that we're not going to reach all the adults, I think that there are fantastic opportunities with young children. And one of the strategies that we're taking is to partner with other organizations who already have large followings. And in the area of kids, there is a, I don't know if any of you have ever heard of babycenter.com. How many of you have heard of babycenter.com? They have the largest distribution of information for mothers of newborn infants. And they're one organization, as an example, that we are starting to partner with to disseminate practices for young mothers who can then, by example, through social learning, help to cultivate these qualities that we're talking about in their children. I think that we need what I alluded to in my talk as major public health campaigns to underscore the urgency and the need for using media to communicate this kind of message as broadly as we can with the right kinds of partners. Another organization that we're partnering with is National Geographic, where we have been in a dialogue with them about the historical concept that National Geographic has pioneered of exploration and turning that to exploring the mind and cultivating well-being as an opportunity to explore the mind. And so I think that there will be some important developments over the next couple of years that will continue to get this message out to the mainstream community to help in the kinds of situations that you're describing. But it's going to be a gradual transition. One of the qualities in the contemplative traditions that we're invited to cultivate is patience. So, yes, please. And then we'll come back to you.
Yes. I just have a question, because when you practice the mindfulness for a while, you see that to practice compassion will come easier than if you haven't done the practice at all, if you are new to this subject. And just let me think just a second. And some people may feel that they're a failure because they can't do the loving kindness meditation with feeling compassion for others, their enemy, their father who did something, their mother who did something, even for themselves. So how can we make them move on to the next level, sort of, because they want to avoid the compassion theme in mindfulness?
Okay, I think I understood the question. So the first part of the question was the suggestion that practicing mindfulness may be helpful initially before a person begins to practice compassion. And the second question had to do with the fact that for some people, practicing compassion may not feel right. They may feel that it's difficult for them to do because of various causes and conditions. I think that one of the things that we've learned scientifically, and I think also is very much emphasized in the contemplative traditions, is that one size does not fit all. There is no meditation practice that's the best. And anyone who says that, I think, is just, it just violates everything that we know scientifically, at least, if you look at the data. And so what we need to do, I think, is to discern the most skillful way to approach things with different kinds of individuals. And one of the important opportunities in current scientific research is to assess a person's emotional and cognitive style and from that assessment, be able to come up with recommendations of specific contemplative practices that may be most optimal for them, given their specific conditions. And so it may be that a particular kind of practice is not appropriate for a person at this present point in their own history, in their own development, and another practice may be more effective. And so we need to do our best to figure that out so that we can help people come to the practice with more skillful means and start with practices that may be initially more effective. But that's an ongoing topic for scientific research. Yes, please.
Some of the themes you spoke about at the beginning, to me, brought up the teachings on subtle body in Buddhism. I wondered whether you could say something about it, because to me it seems that these are very correlated.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so
from your scientific point of view and from the Buddhist point of view, there's a subtle body explanations, channels, chakras, and so on.
Yeah, so the question is really alluding to a lot of Buddhist theory and information about the subtle body, and there's a whole system which I honestly only know a little bit about, with channels that are channels through which certain kinds of energy flow, and there could be blockages in those channels and so forth. And so the question is the extent to which some of the scientific research, and I imagine particularly the research on the body, on the immune system and inflammation and those things, bears on the subtle body. So, you know, from a scientific perspective, I think it's fair to say that the vast majority, I would say like 99%, scientists would say that, you know, the subtle, they have no idea what the subtle body is, and would be quite dismissive, honestly, of ideas about channels and chakras and so forth. What we try to practice in our own laboratory is the practice of not knowing, because there's no scientific evidence that shows that those things are not real, but there's no good scientific evidence that has explored them. And so this is really part of an ongoing discussion that we've been having with many of our Tibetan teachers who have been participants in our studies and with His Holiness the Dalai Lama. And in fact, many of you may be aware that His Holiness the Dalai Lama has written a book on science and spirituality called The Universe in a Single Atom. And he says at the very beginning of that book that if there's any tenet of Buddhism that's directly contradicted by scientific fact, he's prepared to give it up, which is really quite remarkable for the religious leader. May other religious leaders adopt a similar perspective. But he's very careful to distinguish between scientific fact and scientific worldview or scientific hegemony, scientific assumption. And but he does have some very interesting comments in that book about subtle body, and that there are that there is a form of energy that has been described in classical Tibetan Vajrayana Buddhism in particular, that may be a key concept that actually skillfully navigates the issue of how the mind and the brain may be related. And I would encourage those of you who are interested in this to read His Holiness the Dalai Lama and his writings on that, because he appeals to these concepts in Buddhism as a potential way to resolve these these dilemmas in science, which have been historical sort of stumbling blocks in the dialogue between science and Buddhism. Thank you. Oh, you have a mic.
Okay. I have a question concerning the communication between the mind, brain, body. And I'm quite curious about the mind, brain, and the microbiome. And the microbiome, how is the connection here, and has there been done any studies concerning mindfulness, MBSR training, and how it connects with the microbiome? Or is it the microbiome who, in a way, is the leader of the mind or the brain? Because yeah. I think this is very interesting.
Yes, thank you for the question. I assume all of you heard it. So the question is about the relationship between the microbiome and the mind and the brain. First of all, the connection goes in both directions, clearly. It's not one leading the other. It's each in a mutual dance together. And this is an issue which is being explored intensively these days. We know that there is a massive array of neurons in the gut which is monitoring the microbiome. And there are really good data now, hard-nosed scientific data, showing that variations in the microbiome will be reflected in variations in patterns of baseline brain activity. So that changes in the microbiome are associated with changes in brain activity. This clearly indicates that there are connections between them, that manipulation of the microbiome will affect the brain in ways that are likely to be very consequential for our experience and our behavior. Whether or how specific contemplative practices which may influence the mind and the brain influence the microbiome, that we don't know. That has not been explored to the best of my knowledge. I don't know any study that has looked at that yet, but I do know that there are some studies that are beginning to look at that, but there's nothing yet in the scientific literature. So I think this is going to be a very important area, and again, it's part of this axis of the communication between the mind, brain, and the body, which is extensive, and that's one mechanism through which this occurs. Yes, please.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for interesting talks. It's perhaps a little bit of philosophical question, because we have an image of the brain today. Going a little bit back a few hundred thousand years, it would have looked different. We are getting more and more people on the earth, that's my question to you. What do you think will how would the brain look in the future? Also, we've got to what we're talking about here with compassion. Is compassion the most important thing we have to develop for this species' survival? Because I assume that the brain development has to do with the species survival through the times.
Yeah. So you asked quite a few questions. I have no idea what the brain is going to look like in the future. It's a really interesting question to ponder. One of the things we do know, though, is that the classical evolutionary mechanisms through natural selection that have changed the brain over the course of evolution are very, very, very slow. And so whatever changes may occur in the brain through the classical mechanisms of natural selection are going to be changes that are very slow. And so 100 years from now, I think I can fairly confidently say that the brain is going to look pretty much the same as it looks right now. Because the mechanisms of natural selection don't operate on that time scale. Now, there may be at a microstructural level differences because of epigenetic kinds of influences and plasticity, but the gross morphology of the brain is not going to change that quickly. Now, in terms of the second part of the question about what's the most important qualities to cultivate, I mean, certainly I think compassion is up there. But I wouldn't regard myself as, you know, I would ask someone who is, I think, much more well qualified to answer that question than I am, someone like the Dalai Lama. Yeah, so sorry I can't be more helpful.
Hi, thank you very much for being here. I have a question about if you know any research or that Vipassana has been used within recovery in mental health care? Or as a part of the recovery?
Yeah, in mental health care. Well, there, you know, part of it depends on exactly what form of Vipassana we're talking about. Vipassana refers to insight. There are different kinds of insight practices and different traditions. So, but there have been a few studies explicitly on Vipassana practices, but I don't know of any that have been specifically focused on recovery in patients with psychiatric disorders. But actually, maybe you guys who just presented know the answer to that. I don't know if there are any, I don't know of any specific scientific data on the use of Vipassana in seriously psychiatrically ill patients and looking at mechanisms of recovery. There probably is a wealth of clinical insight around that, but not scientific studies. Yeah.
I have a question. It builds on your answer earlier where you talked about the His Holiness the Dalai Lama and his willingness in the face of scientific fact to give up a belief that was proven otherwise. And you said earlier in the 70s and 80s it was a very bad career move to investigate things like mindfulness and meditation, compassion. And obviously that's been proven otherwise. Do you think that we'll get to a point in the future where we won't need to rely on scientific evidence and we'll believe more about our embodied knowledge or somatic experience? I realize it's a bad question to ask a scientist.
I appreciate you asking it. You know, there are many different reasons to do science. The primary reason for the motivation for me is multiple. It's not a single motivation, but one motivation is really to understand the fundamental nature of reality. We're not even remotely close to that. I think that there's going to be a great interest in continuing to do science for a long time to come in this area because we're so far from truly understanding how this all actually works and what the nature of the mind is. I just don't see that ending anytime soon. Now, I realize that that's not exactly your question. And so, I'm a scientist who has access to our own MRI scanner. I can go in the MRI scanner every single day if I wanted. I do go in a lot, but I don't go in every day. But, you know, I've actually never, this is just an honest confession, I've been meditating since the mid-1970s, and I've never, quote, checked my own brain to see how I'm doing with my meditation, ever. And I can do it anytime I want, I've never done it. And it's not, I don't really think it's because I'm afraid of what I might see, although maybe occasionally, but not really. But I, you know, I do rely on my own internal guideposts and not on scientific evidence to do that. I think that we can use the science in a way to help motivate people and to take this work more seriously and to help them appreciate the idea that our brains are constantly being shaped. And why not take responsibility for our own brains when we can and shape them in ways which are healthier and which can promote more happiness and greater well-being. And so using the scientific evidence in that way, I think, can help people get more in touch with their own bodily and internal signals, if you will. And they don't need to rely on scientific information for them personally to do that. It may be an initial motivator, but it's actually one of the reasons why I'm not a big fan of biofeedback or neurofeedback. Because I think that it's important for people to be able to discern the signals inside themselves and not have to rely on some kind of external device to provide those signals. So thank you. Yes, please. Yes,
my question is from a scientific research point of view. To what degree can compassion increase by training in a person? Is there a limit?
We have no idea if there's a limit. What we have seen in many studies that have been done is that there is a relation between certain kinds of outcomes that we measure and the length of the person's practice. And so the more they practice, the larger the effects that we see in certain cases, not always, but in certain cases. But we certainly don't know that there's a limit. It's not like compassion is a limited resource on the planet. The more you use it, the less there is in the overall pool. I've been privileged and honored to spend a lot of time around His Holiness the Dalai Lama over the last 20 years, and always just so deeply inspired by his expression of compassion at every moment, in every interaction. I think that that's a living example of how, of the kind of further reaches of compassion that are possible. I would say that those kind of living examples should be a kind of inspiring standard, if you will. His Holiness practices a lot. By his report, an average of 4 or 5 hours a day. So thank you. Yes. I don't know where we are with time. Maybe one more question. Sorry, I know this can go on for hours. I would love it, but... Oh, sorry. We'll do two questions.
Thank you. It's a question that follows up on the lady over here, and it is a very short one. Could you please give your definition of the mind?
That's a really short question. But it would require a very long answer. I honestly can't. It would require a long philosophical discussion.
It's just that you use both brain and mind, kind of.
The reason I use both brain and mind, that I can answer. The reason I use both brain and mind is because I try to do my best as a neuroscientist to not fall into the trap of automatically assuming that the mind is simply what the brain does. If you look on the website of the MIT Department of Brain and Cognitive Science, it's a very famous department, and many friends of mine are in that department, and I've studied in that department. You will see on the website that it very prominently says, the mind is what the brain does. That, I think, is hogwash. And I think it just violates so many hard-nosed scientific facts, such as the influence of the microbiome. We know that there are 200 million neurons in the gut. To say that the mind is simply what the brain does ignores so much. And so I try to be as careful as I can and remind myself that the mind is something that is more than just the brain.
I wonder if you can say something about what you consider some of the most important areas for research on mindfulness to look into in the years to come, and what you yourself would like to do.
Great question. Thank you for asking me. This will be the last question, very appropriately. So there are a few things that I am very passionate about exploring, other than some of the more practical things which we've already talked about, like work with children and so forth. But one of the deep things that we do not know is the way mindfulness is being taught in most cases, not all, but in most cases in the West, is really removed from its original context. And one of the important qualities of that original context is the ethical framework in which it's embedded. And I am deeply interested in studying how that ethical framework may make a difference. And in fact, there is some reason to believe that simply the ethical framework itself, without the techniques of mindfulness, may be as, if not more, powerful in influencing certain kinds of outcome measures than the actual techniques of, quote, mindfulness themselves. And so we do not know that from a scientific perspective, but it is something that can be studied. And so I think that there's a real need to study that, and it's something that we hope to do. The second thing is, how many people here have heard of analytic meditation? Okay. I think that it's a good, maybe 10 people. Well, the kind of practice that His Holiness the Dalai Lama does is mostly analytic meditation. And nobody knows what it is in the West. It is a family of practices which can be studied scientifically and are extremely important in the contemplative traditions. And there's not a single scientific study that's ever been done on analytic meditation. And yet, it, for many people like His Holiness the Dalai Lama, it's the most important kind of practice that they do. And so the kind of mindfulness practices like awareness of breathing are not the kind of practices that have been mostly done in those other traditions. And so we in the West have been looking at a teeny, teeny fraction of the practices which have been so important in the, particularly the Buddhist contemplative traditions. And so there's critical need for the scientific study of those other kinds of practices. And again, it's something that's completely amenable to scientific study. So those are two important areas that I think will receive more and more attention. Now there's a whole bunch of things that I could say about cool scientific techniques that we can apply to the study of all kinds of meditation, but that's kind of like being a scientific geek and probably less relevant to this audience. But in terms of really deep issues that are important, those are two. So thank you all so much, and it was really an honor to be with you today.